Greetings and salutations, everybody. What a wonderful turnout. Put it in the chat if you're really excited and ready for Sagittarius season. It is the first full day of Sagittarius season. We're finally out of Scorpio. Yay. Scorpio was crazy. The last bit too, especially, wasn't it? With the full moon, I can't even begin to describe how intense that was. We talked about that just on Friday with the wisdom moon for everyone who was there. But if you weren't, oh, the stories we shared, I can't even believe. But as all things come and go and move through cycles and waves and magical flows, we now get to turn ourselves to a new point in time, a new cycle, a new energy, a new archetype to learn to dance through us with more awareness and love and connection than ever before. And in that, we get to learn and discuss about the nature of centaurs, the nature of Sagittarius, and what it means, not just astrologically, but on the human level. How does this relate with the holiday season? You know, because there's a few different seasons that are happening now. And this next month, from this point up until December 21st, and a few days of Capricorn, is a buildup towards what is one of the most celebrated holidays. Not everywhere, of course, but it's pretty big. It's a pretty big deal. So congratulations. If you're watching this video, you made it through Scorpio. And Scorpio is a period that can be very hard on many of us, pushing us to our limits and invoking the states of death, transformation, and surrender if we're willing. If we're willing should be a key word. Even if we're not willing, you know, might be easier to do the dance if we are than if we're not, if we're resistant to the change. Scorpio being co-ruled by Mars and Pluto, which if you know anything about astrology, Mars is very fiery, masculine, action-oriented energy. And Pluto is like an explosion. That's kind of the difference between the two. And so Mars and Pluto together, they are going to push on us through that Scorpio season, no matter what, and create a fiery intensity for our egos to do battle with. And so if you had any stress or intensity or implosions or explosions of any kind over the last month, then you definitely felt a little bit of that Scorpio season. And I'm just seeing all the chats here, all of the different things that we've been through. So the good news is that we're out of the fire of Scorpio and into the fire of Sagittarius. True story. Because that's the truth of it. Scorpio is actually a water sign, but it's kind of like boiling water. The beautiful thing about Sagittarian fire is that it's actually a lot gentler. We had the explosions of Pluto and Mars with Scorpio, and now we're taking that and we're just simmering it down, bringing the energy in more in our hearts. And that's really where we're at today. So, season of the Centaur. This is where we're starting here today, and what's going to be theming the rest of our experience here over the next 30 days or so. And we wanted to take some time to talk specifically about centaurs in general, because Sagittarius, as we know him to be, is a centaur. And what does that even mean? You might be familiar with the idea a centaur is a half man, half horse creature, but getting into their nature is a whole nother story. So mythologically, the centaurs do come from Greek myth and were said to be a primal being, existing in tribes and making homes in caves, hunting wild animals and stuff like that. So they were a very tribal species. And there's actually a definition of centaur. If you look it up on Google or whatever search engine we use, the dictionary websites, a centaur is considered any of a group of icy asteroids that orbit the sun, primarily between Jupiter and Neptune, whose orbits they cross. Some centaurs appear to be more like comets than asteroids. So we've actually adapted, just as we've adapted a lot of the Greek gods and sometimes Roman gods for the planetary bodies in the sky, from Mercury to Jupiter and everything in between. We also have centaurs, just like Chiron, we're going to talk about soon too, who is a little asteroid-like comet thingy, And we have centaurs in our solar system. So we can look at this in a sense of astrology or astrologically speaking, it's often described that the planets represent you. The farther out they get are actually the farther deeper within you. So the sun, being like the center of the solar system, is your personality, the way that you express yourself in your totality in your day-to-day waking life. And then Mercury, and then Venus, and then Mars, and so on and so forth. And so you're getting to Uranus and Neptune and Pluto, which are speaking to the deepest depths of our being. Then there's Chiron. We're going to talk about him soon. But he is the immortal wounded healer centaur. And he also finds his name in our modern astrological and astronomical books. So talking about centaurs and then this mythology and how it relates to us right now is a really big subject. And to help us learn a little bit more about this, I'm going to invite the lovely Amelia Mapstone to join us here on stage and to share with us some wisdom about the nature of the centaur.
Hello, everyone. Oh, I love seeing the chat light up. It is indeed lit today with all the Sag energy. So I've got some special hot tea for you on the nature of the centaur. And this picture kind of describes it all. A lot of the art depicted of centaurs was rather violent. They were known for being, as you can see, savage, rowdy, and boisterous. And this is partially because they were followers of Dionysus, who was the god of wine and partying and pleasure. It's funny because Sag is a very fire sign, right? And yet there's this earth element to it of enjoying the sensual pleasures, enjoying your five senses, roaming the earth and appreciating the beauty of it, and also maybe going a little overboard, right, with this wine. The Greeks even used centaurs as sort of like omens in a way, warning signs about being careful when it comes to alcohol, not going too overboard. So they represented chaos, barbarism, and again, even alcoholism, and this sort of overextending of your pleasures or the overindulgence. And so already we're starting to see this balance here and this sense of beast and man nature happening. And with that being said, as Jordan mentioned, we'll be talking a bit about Chiron, because most people think that Sagittarius comes from Chiron. He's the most famous, well-known of the centaurs when it comes to Greek mythology. And he was this way because he was very special. He was unlike all of the other centaurs. He was very practical, very much in the arts. And yes, he knew how to shoot a bow and arrow. He was an archer, but he didn't do it necessarily out of, you know, violence or the need to start wars. It was more so to appreciate the art of hunting, to add more beauty to an already abundant process. So it was more so that he was almost like Taurin in nature, for those of you who are familiar with astrology, in the sense that he had a deep connection to Venus energy and this divine feminine sense of beauty. So he was an incredibly wise tutor and advisor to heroes like Hercules, Achilles, and Jason, all of whom are also astrological figures throughout the zodiac, which is pretty cool. But he is not Sagittarius. So contrary to popular belief, astrologically, he is, as Jordan mentioned, an asteroid, the wounded healer, which if you're looking at a chart, you often look to it to see both how you are wounded and how you might wound others. So there's a dynamic there that's in play. But his constellation is actually called Centaurus. So he has the like OG centaur constellation, which is a bit different. And yet when we look at Sagittarius as a constellation, it looks like a centaur, right? So as you can see, this is like a gorgeous art interpretation of the constellation itself. And it does in fact have four legs, right? So we're already seeing this like horseplay, if you will, come out in the stars. And this is an excerpt from a mythological interpretation of Greek myth, the OG myth, if you will, of Sagittarius, the origin story. So some say that he is Crotus, not Chiron, son of Pan by Euphemia, nurse of the Muses. So just to break this down a little bit for those who aren't as familiar with Greek mythology, Pan is the trickster god, and he's also the father of satyrs. So being a son of Pan means that you are half man, half goat, generally speaking. And the Muses were these goddesses of beauty and art and divinity. They're sort of like little I would call them baby Venuses or baby Aphrodites, in the sense that they're these, it's like a multiplicity of divine feminine. And Crotus was a satyr who lived on Mount Helicon with the muses and got to know the culture, got to know art, beauty, history. And yes, he also practiced hunting. And again, similarly to Chiron, he practiced hunting to hone in on his craft, to really focus on bringing an art to it rather than just sort of, you know, going out and wreaking havoc. And in this way, actually, satyrs and centaurs are not very different. Satyrs are also honored by the god Dionysus, which you can actually see at the end of this excerpt. Chiron became a constellation out of a sense of martyrdom. He was, again, the wounded healer. And so he became immortalized in the stars as a sort of saving him, as a sort of transformation. And Sagittarius's transformation is different. When he goes to the stars, he goes because he is famousized. That's not the right word, but he had great fame, and everyone wanted to remember him, especially the muses. So they asked Zeus to bring him to the stars to be immortalized because he was such a good archer. He was very swift, clever in the arts. And that is a very intentional plural thing, right? Because Sagittarius energy does all the things, right? There is focus when it comes to shooting that arrow. And there is also this exploration. Like, you shoot the arrow and then you go follow it to see where it goes. He doesn't necessarily know where it goes. He's exploring. So there's the sense that he had a hand and a foot, or several feet as it were, in all of these arts and all of this beauty that the human and the gods could create together. So since he wished to display all his skills in one body, he being Zeus, Zeus wanted to display all of the wonderful skills of Crotus in the Sagittarius constellation. He gave him horse flanks. So there are still horses here. It is still relevant, I promise. He rode a great deal, which is kind of a funny thing to imagine, like a satyr riding a horse. It's almost like a mind trip sort of thing. But yeah, so he had horse flanks because he rode a great deal, and it also symbolized the sense of strength and stability and divine masculine, you know, musculature. He added arrows since these would show his keenness and his swiftness with the bow and his precision in everything that he did. He might have explored everything, and he was also very focused on each little thing, each little detail. And of course, he gave him a satyr's tail to honor that which he was, because the muses took no less pleasure in Crotus than Dionysus did in the satyrs. So there you can see this sort of overlapping that we have here between centaurs and satyrs. In general, for us, with like modern mythology and modern astrology, they both represent a dynamic within ourselves, of course. And we can definitely see this in Sagittarius as a whole. And this dynamic is very beautiful, and it is very beastly. And it's the beauty and the beast in all of us. And it's this idea that, you know, we have our higher natures, if you will, our top half, literally, when it comes to those centaurs and satyrs. And then we have our lower half, which is the beastly, the lower chakras, the more instinctual, directly plugged in and connected to earth. And if it's anything we talk about here in Spirit Mysteries, it's how to balance the two, how to dance between them. And I just had to include this shot because it's just, you know, the dynamic, the dance that happens within you. Plus, I don't know about you guys, but the beast kind of looks like maybe he could be a very big, bulky satyr. So I thought that was cool. And I'm sure he knows how to ride a horse, so it tracks. But so this is what we're exploring with this energy. Thickest satyr faces. Heck yeah. So how does this relate to the holidays? Because again, as Jordan mentioned, this is the season of all kinds of things. It's multiple seasons happening. We have this beautiful higher nature of hope, love, faith, and wisdom, and celestial downloads and deep connections with the divine, going to mass, prayer. And then we have this on the right, which is the beastly lower nature, you could say, of this energy within us, of this half man, half beast energy. And it's interesting because in Scorpio season, we were kind of all beast, right? It was all underworld, all animal energies, right? The eagle, scorpion, and phoenix. And then here we start to approach this blurred line section with Sagittarius, this combination of man and beast. And, you know, that's the Black Friday scramble right there. I'm not sure I really have to explain it, but what's interesting to me, and I had this epiphany the other day, is that Sagittarius teaches us how to harmonize these energies, how to love both of them and explore both of them at the same time, with an understanding that there is a richness in both and all of them. If we have any Sagittarius placements here, I would love for you to throw it in the chat, because we were talking about this morning in the Seeker gathering, and I was like, do you have any Sag placements? And the chat just lit up. So represent, Sag, if you are in there. Yes, rising sign, Sag Mars. You love to see it. Oh my gosh, so many. Yes. Okay, good. So you guys are already vibing with this energy. And the beauty of it too is, even if you don't have that energy in your chart explicitly, it's within you still energetically. So we're going to explore this together throughout this whole season, the balance between the beast and the human. So as it says, between November 21st and December 21st, we are in Sagittarius season. This means that our sun is in the space, the home of the constellation Sagittarius. And again, if your systems are different, those dates might vary a little bit, but this is the bracket that we're using. Sagittarius is ruled by Jupiter, which is the planet of many things, is how I like to describe him. Jupiter is also the planet of expansion, adventure, learning, higher learning, as well as experimentation and less known money and prosperity. So if you're working with like stretching your abundance energy, bringing more money into your wallet, like Jupiter's actually a really great good luck charm to work with, if you will. So Sagittarius is a creature of grand journey, whether that's in the mind, the spirit, or the body. It seeks to step free of childhood limitations and become citizens of the world. This is the most evolved fire sign of the whole zodiac, right? It collects the fiery spark of Aries with the loving protection energy of Leo and brings it forth into Sagittarius in this evolved fire, ever expanding like a wildfire and within reason, understanding that the world that it consumes is also a world that can be given back to. So already we have this idea of like receiving and giving coming in here. And there's a huge focus on broad inquiry and fascination with cultural diversity. Again, my Sag placements. How much do you like learning? How much do you like sampling? There's always a little sample to taste, a little thing to do. And in that way, we think back to this idea of the Centaur in enjoying pleasures like wine, sex even, you know, like that sort of energy carries in through Scorpio into Sagittarius here. And we're learning more practical, balanced ways to enjoy all of these things and to not fall to temptation necessarily or to go overboard, but to allow these experiences to be vessels for our spiritual downloads and our learning and expansion. So it's more about the journey and experiences rather than the destination. There is no goal, even though Sagittarius will always hit the target spot on in the bullseye. Again, he follows the arrow. It's the follow through that counts with Sag, the tracking of it all. Like, okay, I hit this target this time, but I'm going to shoot again. And let me just like, you know, shoot behind me real quick and see where that goes. Like, it's that playful energy of bringing your child self to the rest of the world in a very expansive, playful way. So it does not want to work within the confines of other people's timetables. How many of you Sagittarius placements do deadlines? Especially if you have like Mars in Sag, it's probably not a good idea to restrict yourself with deadlines, at least as much as possible, because there's that sense of like agitation that can happen from this. Sagittation, if you will. Yeah, so the breadth and the scope of the journey, literal or philosophical, makes Sagittarius a collage artist, fascinated by systems and ways of organizing information, willing to explore many different philosophies and cultures. If travel physically is not an option, then Sagittarius resorts to rich inner journeying, not just going to the borders or limits, but pushing past them. One of the biggest things to remember here, especially as we are in a time where people are still kind of weird about travel, is you can learn so much from going within. Travel is not just external. You don't just go on adventures outside of yourself. The adventure within is also very zesty to Sagittarius. And in that way, he's very similar to his sister Scorpio and takes a page out of her book, because when he's getting antsy and restless, it's a good idea for him to sit with it and go within and see how he can explore in maybe a different way than what he was expecting. So that is the download of Sagittarius. And on that note, let's have a quick check-in. How are you all doing? Deadlines are so bad for me, someone says. Rising Aries totally agrees. Yeah, any of the fire signs don't want to be controlled. So hard. Yeah. Right, you got to set your own deadlines. Mm-hmm. And Sagittarius is mutable fire as well. I don't know if I mentioned that, which means it's just this adaptable energy, this expansion. So what is your guys' biggest takeaway for this new season? How do you feel about what we're entering here? Because you just walked through quite the fiery doorway and you're on the other side of transformation now. Are you guys ready? How do you feel? Hayden's ready to get the ball rolling after all that he shed from Scorpio. Yes, there was a lot of shedding. So ready, let's go. A big temperance. Ooh, I can hardly keep up with the chat, I love it. Scorpio has you washed clean, balance and alchemize. Yes, this is great, guys. We're manifesting such good vibes in the chat. And with that being said, I'm going to pass it back.
Thank you very much, Amelia. That was really great. You learn a lot? How was that little session? Put it in the chat. Give some props to Amelia for all of the wisdom there as far as centaurs go. Thank you. And all of the blessings for all
love
of you guys.
Guys.
So as we do every month when we gather on these transitional events, we always reveal the new theme of the month. And 3 months ago, when we launched the new platform of Spirit Mysteries, we announced the first three themes, right? The first was psychedelics, then it was inner balance, and then it was practical magic. And we never yet revealed what the new theme of the month was for anything after that. And this is going to be sort of an ongoing revelatory process. Today, we are actually announcing the next two themes. But before we can do that, as is also customary for these magical events, it's time for a group meditation. And so we're going to enter together into a magical space of Sagittarian energy to cleanse that old completion of the Scorpio, leaving it behind. Thank you for the lessons. And moving here into a new frequency. I want to ask everybody right now to get yourself settled into a meditative posture, whatever that means for you. If you're lying down, if you're sitting down, if you need to do a little stretch first, just open things up. You want to open up your energy field, maybe both physically, and you just maybe just stretch out energetically as well. Make your magic circle, your energetic field, right? Your Merkaba, your light body. Just breathe in the energy field. And as you're getting settled, you can start to close your eyes. Breathe out. Take it in. We just get that energy flowing through us. We just get the motion in the ocean. It's time to leave behind the old vibe and step into something new. So let's just feel within us and let's start to visualize that you're washing up. You're just entering this meditation, washing up on a beach. There's this water splashing up against you. It's comfortable, but it was intense. You knew that you just got thrown about in some way. But you're touching the ground now. You're touching the sand. And you can feel it between your toes and your fingers. And you're breathing and you're pushing yourself up and you're starting to stand up. And you're just going to start walking out of the waters of Scorpio. Waters of Scorpio season to the sun-bleached sand of Sagittarius. And you're walking onto this beach. And you're looking around, taking it all in, what is in the environment. And you see, you know, it's a bright, sunny day, that there's some trees, maybe some palm trees, some bushes. But it looks like off in the distance, there's a building. And you see this building, and it's got beautiful architecture. It's got just absolutely magnificent pillars, and it looks all marble and white and kind of ancient, but pristine. And so as you're, you know, shaking off the water of Scorpio, just letting yourself loosen up and free yourself of that torrential past that you just came out of in the last season, you start moving towards this building. And as you're crossing the sand, that the sun and the warmth, it starts to dry you to prepare yourself to enter into this building. And as you approach closer to the building, you're noticing that it's actually a lot larger. It's a lot larger than you previously thought. The steps are ginormous, and the great door is magnificently large. And you start to take some steps up to this building because you just feel called to be inside. And you see that there are these carvings of centaurs on the sides of the buildings, on the great doors, that as you approach them, they slowly start to open. Maybe they creak as they just slowly, because these are massive doors, just start to push open, inviting you in. And you feel this gravity start to pull on you. You are compelled into this great dark building. You can't really see what's inside of it yet, but you start to walk in and you feel this presence, like ancestral wisdom, that is now all around you, starting to become almost as if it's in the air, that the further that you walk into the building, the more every breath you take, it's like richer and richer with wisdom and knowledge. And there's so much of it. So just take a moment and breathe in that knowledge, that wisdom. Presence it. And as you exhale, you are giving your knowledge into this space too. And you start moving in and in into the darkness. And suddenly a lantern on your right and on your left, a light. And then another one just a little bit in front of those. Whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. All of these lanterns start lighting up, illuminating a great hallway in front of you. And everything just suddenly comes alive, and you recognize that you are in a library. That rows and rows and rows of bookshelves, as tall as the eye can see and stretching far back, as far as you can see into the distance, just fill your entire consciousness that this is the Hall of Amenti, containing the Akashic records, the great library of all knowledge and experience and wisdom ever accumulating by humanity throughout all epochs and generations, including a whole section for Atlantis and Lemuria and Sumeria and Egypt, and even the Dark Ages, and even the Industrial Age, and the Renaissance, and the Age of the Internet. The entire Internet is accumulated in a section of this library. And you're walking down the halls, and you're just looking at all the books, at all the knowledge that could possibly be known. And you realize in this moment that were you to stay here for 1,000 years, you still would not be able to read at all. And a wind blows through the environment through the library, you hear it, and then you hear this clip, clop, as a large centaur, twice the size of you, walks through the library and comes out from behind a bookshelf. And he sees you, and you see him, and you stare at each other for a moment. And he says, "Welcome to this library. Choose your profession. Choose your craft, your knowledge, your interest, and choose wisely. And let me know if you have any questions." And then, like a good librarian, he picks up his books, he looks at them, and he says, "Ah, yes." And then he turns around to go and file more books in the library. And you suddenly are filled with this Sagittarian impulse. Because Sagittarius, by its nature, carries that bow, that archer. And he shoots the bow to great distances and great depths in learning about specific things. And learning everything that there is to know about the specific things that you may not be able to learn everything in the library, but you can learn one thing really well, or a small number of things with exceptional focus. And you must ask yourself what that thing is, where you really called to be. And now in this moment, you are free to choose. And so take a breath, go within to aim your arrow. And I want you to choose where in the library that you choose to walk, that there is nothing off limits to you. There is no restricted section. You can learn anything that you want to. But you must walk to that part of the library and pick up a book based on your heart's calling and the intuition of your higher self. So we're going to take a moment now to walk the library and see what we find. remembering the fullness of your breath, take in to yourself, your heart and your mind, the fullness of the subject you wish to learn. And anchor that in now, here in this moment. Anchor in that which is your desired subject, that you may not lose it, that it will be with you, and that you can stay in this part of the library, or even explore other parts of the library as you see fit over this next month. For the great Centaur has given you his blessing to remain here. And while here, there is nothing that is off limits. That this is an astral space that is now available to you as we go throughout this season. And that many opportunities await themselves for you to discover as you stumble with great joy throughout the halls of this library. You might even find sections of the library that you didn't even know was there before. Did you know they have a planetarium? I just found out myself. What's especially amazing is as you walk throughout this library, opening books here and there, you might even find that some of the books play videos, just like in Harry Potter. And so the world is your library. As we bring this meditation back to our bodies and engage with the world physically, just as we engage astrally, we find that everything in life becomes the library. That you can learn from everything. Nothing is off limits. But to choose your profession carefully, what videos do you find yourself watching? What books do you find yourself reading? What conversation do you find yourself having? You might find there's some things, parts of the library that you're already familiar with. You don't need to read those books again. You can leave them behind and go to a new part. And you have that power of choice. So now, as your astral body remains in the library, free to explore, create a link now, a bridge to your physical form. That as you return to your body, your mind, your heart stays in the library so that you can live with this level of consciousness as you go throughout the season of the Centaur. And breathe in and out. And when you're ready, start to move your body. Wiggle your fingers. Wiggle your toes. Wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. Maybe stretch your neck. Roll your shoulders. Roll your head. Why not? Whatever feels good, but we loosen up because we were tossed about by Scorpio season. And it's time to bring into us a little bit of controlled burning, that this is a purposeful fire, an important fire, a mutable fire, a fire of change, but also a fire of depth in our hearts. And we start to be present. Welcome back. I have a question for you now before we move on. Where did you go in the library? And it's okay if you're still taking some time to return to your body. But if you have the capacity to put it in the chat, where in the library, what subject healing with music to the healer section. That's beautiful. Healing of mind, body, spirit, the nurturing section. I love that. Healing and magic. This is very exciting that healing is coming up. Magic and art. I feel so validated. I ran hands over books after books. Healing with coaching, art therapy, storytelling, guitar knowledge, energy healing. Beautiful. Beautiful. There's so much healing. That's so exciting. Congratulations. We have a community of healers. Thoth section. Very nice. Self-love, alchemy and transformation, abundance. That's a good one. Relationship healing. Reiki and crystals. Knowledge of recondite. I don't even know what that means. Green books full of money and abundance. I love that subject. World and life building, sculpting and crafting, letting go and releasing. Wow, guys, there's so many. I can't even read them all. This is incredible. Earth wisdom, jumping down to the bottom of it, channeling ancient and Atlantis and Egypt, raising consciousness. Blessed. Let's remember that. Let's stay there and let your soul compel your actions. That over this next season, especially, make a note that you're still in that library. Some part of you, your astral body, is in that library. And that over this next period of time, that maybe you'll find yourself looking up a subject that you'll want to learn about here in 3D as well. So take some time to do that research, whatever it is. And it's time at last, moving forward, as we're going together throughout Season of the Centaur, is we have another theme of the month. And this is the long-awaited moment. Between Sagittarius and Capricorn season, which marks the end of 2021 and the beginning of 2022, over the next 2 months, we will be closing old cycles and then opening new ones together. If you think about it this way, like all of 2021 has been coming and moving past us, and we're about to move into this 2022. And if you know about Sagittarius deadlines, as we talked about, sometimes it can be really daunting to you get to the deadline of something where there's a shift and you're not quite ready for it. And Sagittarius doesn't like deadlines. And especially when they creep up on you and boom, hit you kind of out of nowhere, you're not prepared and you start a new cycle kind of willy-nilly. And this is often how people treat New Year's. People are thinking about Christmas right now or holiday season, oh, and special deals, really. They're not thinking about how do I want my 2022 to be? Generally speaking, because that's not what's on everybody's mind. So everyone builds up this big holiday thing, really excited, and then boom, suddenly January. And January kind of takes people by surprise a little bit, usually. And we want to create a space where over the next month, we are going to be closing 2021 together in a harmonious, balanced, healthy way, and then opening up into 2022 in the most beautiful way we possibly can. So that while everyone is gonna have whatever 2022 they're setting up for themselves by lack of attentiveness to it, we're purposefully planning every moment of how 2022 is going to be. Sagittarius theme is closing cycles. From November 22nd to December 21st, that's it. We are just closing cycles. Closing loose threads, things that were opened in 2021 that we're ready to be closed on for good. This is that next window. And then we're going to be opening new cycles together. And that brings us to the next one, Genesis, Capricorn, a true beginning, if there ever was one. Now, you might have noticed on the last slide, it also said secret synthesis in brackets. We're going to talk about that here in a moment, because in order to prepare for a genesis, we must properly close the cycles, the loose threads that are still lingering open. But it is a mystery school. And I want to acknowledge that not everybody in the mystery school are even on this call. And not everybody in the mystery school might even watch this video. So there's something secret for the people who are watching this video, and you're going to get more out of this next season than those who are just kind of floating through it. So this month, we have a secret theme. Yes, a secret mystery theme for those who have taken the time to immerse themselves in the mysteries. And if you're watching this, that's you. Because again, not everyone's going to watch this video. So this is our monthly theme banner that's going to reveal this secret. But it will only appear on the Spirit Mysteries app, because if you've noticed on the browser, that bottom section of this graphic is cut off and it says secret synthesis. Because this is more than just an Easter egg, for the record too. It alludes to the mysteries revealed when you willingly choose to go deeper. So closing cycles might make sense, right? It's the end of the year, things are closing, times are changing, everything's good. Why secret synthesis? And it's actually because of this card here, resurrection. This is, as you can see, our card for Sagittarius season. It's the card that is linked in the major arcana to Sagittarius. And truth be told, this card went through, if you've read the Book of Patch in the personal notes section, which might be valuable if you haven't read it, to check it out after this. In it, I explain in the personal notes that this card went through more changes as far as its name goes than any other card. Maybe along with the Ten of Wands, which they're probably neck and neck, but this one in particular, interestingly, I think they're both Sagittarius, but this one in particular had a huge amount of time playing with names, and alchemy was one name, and synthesis was another name, whether for the keyword or for the name of the card. Because the resurrection card really does speak to synthesis and alchemy, the fusion of energies. We can see it happening here, right? You have the cups that are pouring, one is pouring fire and one is pouring water, and the fire and the water, these juxtaposed forces are swirling together that brings about the rebirth of the new self. And this is coming, of course, from the previous card, which is death, related with Scorpio, which has to do with the dissolving of all of the old energies, dissolving the old self. So as far as resurrection goes, and what this card is speaking to, the synthesis that's happening is, if you think about it like this, if someone sees closing cycles and they don't have any initiation into the deeper mysteries, they'll think, yeah, you know, whatever's open for this year that I don't want to take into the next year, I'll close them. It's very simple. That's a complete thought right there for someone who's uninitiated. Synthesis is the understanding that those loose threads need to be woven back into the greater tapestry. Let's say you had an actual tapestry hanging on your wall, you know, with like a woven fabric, that some of these threads are coming out. Now, many people closing threads might just mean coming in and snipping those off. And in some cases, that's the right thing to do. But a synthesis is knowing that you can interweave those back with the greater tapestry to make the picture more full. Because when it comes to our lives and how we treat and take care of our energy, we get to practice and play with is merging, not getting rid of old parts of ourselves, but merging it in with the greater wisdom. Another example, let's say that someone has a trouble with anger. The closing threads or closing cycles idea might be, okay, I'm gonna just deal with my anger differently. And that is a resolution that someone could work with, and that would work. But the deeper synthesis is, I'm understanding where that anger is coming from within me, and I'm transforming it into a new expression entirely. So if there's a deepening of wisdom, of understanding of what this is supposed to mean and look like, just allow yourself in the library to open yourself to receiving the understanding as you go throughout the month. And you can talk about it with the members of the community, and you can live it. And by the end of Sagittarius, who knows, maybe we'll revisit this in Capricorn season at our December 21st event in just 30 days. And during that event, maybe we'll revisit it and see if it makes more sense, because we're going to have now walked through the fire instead of just talked about it, which we're doing today. So it's not good enough to just close loose threads. This is just what I've already explained. I have a slide for it. So a loose thread, if this helps in the understanding, a loose thread will continue to unravel unless it is woven back into the greater fabric that it's a part of, right? When you snip that thread, if it gets pulled again, it's just going to keep going. It's not woven back in. It's not tight again. Hence, synthesis. Bringing everything together within you and harmonizing those things into unity and understanding. So we're closing some threads too. And this is a fun little thing. We talked about this a few days ago in the Wisdom Moon, and there was some hype here. The biggest thread that we're closing is Spirit Medicine Walkers, because we opened the course before and we made it available for 30 days. And that was an experience that we have. And then it was closed and the course hasn't been available for a little while. And so as a part of our closing threads, we are taking Spirit Medicine Walkers and bringing it back to the greater tapestry of Spirit Mysteries, where it will live and be available from now until the end of time. And we're also beginning the final season of Patch Tarot 2. For those who are unaware, Patch Tarot, the current edition that you have with the lack of the borders on the sides, is the second edition of Patch Tarot. The first edition was full bordered. It had slightly larger cards, slightly lower quality printing, and then, just slightly less refined art as we went. This is the beginning of the end for Patch Tarot 2. But what does that mean, right? Because the beginning of the end could be a very small thing in time or a very big thing in time. And so this will be our final year of working with Patch Tarot 2 as we make way for Patch Tarot 3. Now, to be very clear, the current forecast for Patch Tarot 3 is the end of 2022. It will be probably this event next year, so 365 days from today, that we will launch and announce Patch Tarot 3. Part of closing threads and closing cycles also means opening the holiday season. As millions of people battle it out online and offline for flat screen TVs and PS5s over the next few days or weeks, we wanted to instead hold a space of harmony and wisdom for the holidays. And that's very, very important to us, because we don't want to contribute to panic and to stress of, oh my God, what am I going to get, and budgets and this and that. It's a whole thing. But we also understand that it is the holiday season. And so, Season of the Centaur, and instead of Black Friday, we're doing a sort of a spirit holiday thing. So through the Season of the Centaur, we have three ways to help guarantee that your holiday season is both relaxed, mindful, and awesome. So the first one is that Spirit Medicine Walkers, as announced, is once again available. And for the season, for the entire season, it will be 50% off the regular price for everyone, only $25 a month, or the annual plan for $150 for a full year, which is actually 50% from what it was before. And before, we didn't have an annual plan. The second is that we're going to be hosting Crystal Friday instead of Black Friday in just 5 days from now, which is going to be live streamed on YouTube, a globally streamed event to support you having the most harmonious and stress-free holiday. So even if you're still going through Black Friday and there's deals and you're getting blasted by people telling you, you know, everything's on sale or whatever it is, you can use this opportunity to just show up to this meditation and just get a nice, gentle inner fire light body going. And in that, be able to go through, especially this weekend, but the entire holidays, as gentle and peaceful and fun as you can. And the last one, because it is the holidays, we wanted to do something special for you guys. So this is a stress-free special number 3, which is that throughout all of Sagittarius season, everything on the Spirit Shop are marked between 35 and 50% off. And this is live right now. There's no rush, there's no panic. It's not like if you don't get Patch Tarot super sale by Friday, you're not gonna get it. for the whole month, you can just peruse and browse to your heart's content without rush of the library. The only thing I will say is that some things that we have, like the spirit shirts or the spirit pants, are limited in quantity. So there is a little bit of a limitation there, but other than that, just, you know, peruse as you see fit. And you might have seen this picture floating around on Spirit Mysteries in the last few days. This is very exciting. We're very happy to announce at long last the brand new Anahata Spirit Shirt. So right now, as you might be familiar, I am even wearing the Shuddha Spirit Shirt. This is the throat chakra. And we jumped. We did the root, the sacral, the solar plexus, and then we went straight up to the throat chakra. And we missed the heart in the middle. And it's not that we missed it. We just wanted to do it really special. But at long last, the heart chakra shirt is ready and it is available for pre-order. So this is the thing about this shirt. They're so new, we don't even have pictures yet. That's a true story. So a limited number of them are available for pre-order right now on the Spirit Shop in case you're willing to take a leap of faith, Patch and She Patch modeling the shirts for us. But the moment that they're ready, we're going to take a whole another photo shoot. And so photos are posting and they're shipping early December. So there's about 30 or 40 that are available for order right now. And then early December, there's going to be another 30 or 40 that will be available for order. And then that's it for the stock for this season. So if you did want to get them, you might want to jump in sooner than later. And I'm just going to leave it at that. And if we do sell out, as I expect we might, then we will very quickly order another batch so that January, February, sometime in there, we will have another batch ready for you. And thank you, Patchman and She Patch, for modeling those for us. So Spirit Mysteries 2022, transitional calendar and themes. This was really fun to draw. So I want to just take you through this picture to really visualize the season that we're in, right? We just ended Scorpio season, which you can see here on the left-hand side of the screen, with practical magic as a theme. So here we are on that November 21st, November 22nd date. That transition brings us into Sagittarius season with closing cycles as the theme for the next 30 days. After that, this is again a big preparation. All of this is closing cycles so that we can start some new ones really solid for Capricorn season with Genesis, starting 2022 the right way. So between November 22nd and January 21st, Spirit Mysteries will hold a space for a closing and an opening energy, right? As we've said. And during this time, we'll be focusing on creating a settling closure to the open and loose ends of the year and collectively shift into a new opening in 2022. So these are these next two cycles that we're moving into together. What's interesting is Sagittarius season is a point of opening because we're starting a new cycle, but the cycle's about closing. Where have I heard that before? I had to include that picture. So thank you. Taking it further, if this wasn't enough, we actually have a very special page and a very special video for you all about Sagittarius season, the season of the Centaur, which you can watch and see all of the special offers and find the spirit shirts and patch throw and all of our books, everything on sale at spiritmysteries.com/centaur season. And that is available for you right now. And you can find it on the sidebar inside of Spirit Mysteries. So I just want to say thank you. Thank you, absolutely everyone, for your time, for your love, for your dedication and your devotion to yourself and your learning and your education, no matter what it is. As you roam throughout this library, this inner astral library for the next month, I just want to say, please go crazy with learning and exploration and use this opportunity to really set yourself up for the best possible year 2022 can possibly be. So thank you again. May you forever be blessed. And thank you for joining us for this season of the Centaur event. And happy holidays. We'll see you again very soon for all of the initiate and seeker events inside of the school, and of course, the mystics and the life support. And without further ado, I say farewell from all of us at Team Spirit, and we'll see you soon. Ciao.